said he might be a little late to be in, that was last time, not this time, yeah.
This is a copy of the agenda, and that's a little worksheet that I had sent around.
Can you send me an agenda? Thank you.
Make it two.
Thank you.
Well, should we start, or?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, so, we can start?
I'm going.
Oh, you're going, okay.
You're on a war, huh?
Surprise.
Okay, so we'll go through this, and I'll take some things out of order, just in case Doug arrives, but public comment, there's no one here from the public, so we'll sit there. I also wanted just to make sure that everyone received the email that Councilman Barge sent around, I forwarded that, and if people haven't had a chance to read it, I'm happy to summarize it for people, but.
I have it, thank you.
I have it, thank you.
And also, Lisa Minnick, I sent that around, so I wanted to copy that.
That was very informational, actually.
From the school committee. And so then why don't we go ahead and approve the minutes from the last meeting, do anyone have any questions, comments, motions to approve?
Motion approved. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so approve the minutes from the September 4th meeting. And now we get to go on to the meat of the meeting, which is to discuss, deliberate, forward motions for recommendations on compensation for elected officials. I had thought, I put together a worksheet that has been passed around, that we would go position by position. That's just my suggestion, I collected some summary data, so we'd all be on the same page. Anyone have any other preferences or desires for how to go?
That's easy for me.
Okay. Okay. So we can, should we start with the mayor, or do people want to make comments first, or have any, then I'll just say, my hope would be that we could come to some sort of consensus on this. I know people may have very strong biases one way or another. I guess what I would ask you to do is, if you have sort of a, if it's a make or break sort of issue, let us know early in the discussion, so we can try to work toward some compromise. Otherwise, I would just suggest you sort of feel it out on a scale of, say, 1 to 10, whether it's a absolute one, which I can't tolerate and I won't approve this, or if there's some wiggle room. So feel yourself out. If you have strong preferences one way or another on an issue, please raise it. As we do.
Speak now or forever hold your peace.
Well, not speak now, but I don't want to get, into. Yeah, I just don't want us to get too far along, and then, you know, someone has an issue that comes up. So if you've got a strong prior.
Can we also maybe, before we get to the actual deliberations, talk a little bit about the considerations we factored in or will factor in?
Sure, sure. No, and
it might be helpful, because if there's something I didn't think of that you thought of, I would go like, oh, yeah.
Well, exactly. I meant this as not a homework to bring to the meeting, but as we discuss this, people will bring considerations.
Right, I just meant before we throw a number out,
oh, sure.
Talk about what,
sure,
what we're going to factor in.
So we'll start with the mayor. Just to reiterate, current salary is $80,000. As a full-time employee, benefits aren't an issue. He's entitled to them, he or she. Benchmark for the 24 cities. The mean was 90,921. The median was 85,000. Looking at how Northampton compares to that, I think this is something worth discussing. Looking at how where Northampton sort of fits into our benchmark. I kind of eyeballed this, but I think Trey, you're probably more familiar with the data. We're a little bit smaller community, we're not quite as wealthy. There seems to be a division, which is clearly apparent in the top spreadsheet, where the wealthier communities are tend toward the eastern part of the state.
I had asked for the trade center, but I thought if I had or I would have worn it. I'm sorry. One of the things I noticed is I was looking at that to sort of see where we fell, and it seemed like there was no clear, obvious, you know, like anything that influenced salary, like there be an income, the size of the population. You know, if you looked, it wasn't consistent. It's not like all the bigger or all the wealthier towns are the ones that necessarily had higher salaries. So it made it hard to compare us, really, to anybody in that sense. There isn't really a rhyme or reason to it that I could tell.
It's politics.
Yeah, thank you. But anyway, I just think it's hard to factor that into your recommendation because you're like, really?
When I went over my homework, I guess first thing I did was look at the list of the towns we have, and just by touching on what you said, I kind of divided it. We took the 24 and we saw that it was kind of scrambled, so there really isn't much of a correlation. So then I looked at, I think it's the eight surrounding communities, maybe around Northampton, and I broke it down to that. And so then I tried to think of the next possible correlation, and the easiest one, the voting improvement, I thought might be the city budget. You have a higher city budget, maybe there's more work for the mayor, maybe they should be compensated more, maybe it's a correlation where if they have a higher budget, the mayor was paid more. And in most instances, it was. But not all instances. I don't know what's going on with Pittsfield, by the way. They have a city budget of $145,000, $146, that seems. What's in Pittsfield?
Well, actually, some medical industry.
GE used to do their plastics.
GE was their, yeah.
Yeah, they develop plastics in Pittsfield, basically. But that's come and gone. I think a Chinese firm owns it now. But
it's still there,
but it's industrially, Pittsfield was very wealthy, you know, 50, 75 years ago. And I think it's in decline now.
Yeah.
Plus, it's population-wise, so for delivery of services, because they have 44,000 people.
That large, yeah.
Right. So part of it is that, you know, services cost money, and there's just more people and more roads and more water and more sewer and more.
Yeah, that just struck me. Sorry, I didn't go off on too much of a tangent there. I just struck out of me. Anyway, so what I did there was I tried to look at the differences between city budgets compared to Northampton and then compensation for the mayor compared to Northampton. And what I came out was an average compensation per position, excluding Northampton, was about $84,000. And the surrounding communities, their budget is an average of 10% higher, while their compensation, excluding camp again, is an average 6% higher. So that kind of goes against it, my initial thought, because their budget is 10% higher, but their mayor's salary is only 6% higher. If the mayor's salary was higher than that 10% budget variance, then I would think, like, okay, maybe there's a correlation. So, just to get us, like, hit the ground running.
Mm-hmm.
Coming off of that, my thought was maybe the current salary was adequate, unless, I can't remember the last time it was adjusted, if it should be adjusted for inflation, since the last time it was adjusted, but I can't remember that. And I thought it was longer than that.
I was on that committee, and that's more than, it's 5 or more years.
Yeah, and that's what I thought. I thought it was a while ago, so that's why I thought, if anything, I think we're on par, this criteria.
Okay.
I think with those surrounding communities, I think it's level, but if it does need to be adjusted for inflationary factors, then I would.
Well, the question is when it will be looked at again, because this group got charged with at least every 10 years. So I sure hope it's going to be sooner than that, but there is no requirement to do it sooner than that.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dennis, you've been here longer than, I don't know who's been here longer, but been in town, if you were here 5 years ago, is it something that periodically the council revisits?
No, I mean, basically that's what's weird about it. Just like there really is no correlation, or you can make any correlation kind of thing. Basically, all the unions and the non-represented people get COLA, although it's not really a COLA because it's not necessarily tied to anything. So the people call it COLA adjustment. The unions call it a COLA adjustment, but it's really just a pay adjustment. You know, and they get it every year because by law they can only negotiate contracts for 3 years and no other things for 3 years. The elected people don't have any COLAs. There's no system that adjusts it from year to year. And so what happens is exactly what we're doing. Every 5 years, cities or whatever, even the town managers, the board of selectmen do it every year, and they give the town manager, the town administrator, a cost of living raise. The elected people, and mainly the mayor, doesn't have anything like that. And usually it's every 5 years that some committee gets together and do what we do to make a recommendation, and they get no pay adjustments again until another 5 years or 7 years or 10 years. And so that's just the way the system works. And so one of the questions I was going to pose to the group was, for our recommendation, is our charge just to make the recommendation for fiscal year 15 right now? Or can we say, we recommend the salary to be for fiscal year 15 X. We recommend the salary for fiscal year 18 to be. You know, we recommend the physical,
right?
You know,
have to take it.
And in that sense, I would want to tier it to take into account COLA adjustments, you know, so that if everybody else in the city is getting a 2-2-2 over a 3-year period, then the question begs the question, but then this is the politics of it, you know, it's...
But it does seem equitable, though, too.
Right, so I didn't know if we wanted to have that before we talk numbers, because then it's like, are we only coming up with one recommendation, because I'm going to have a different number if, for me anyway, what I'm thinking, versus if we were making a recommendation for fiscal year 15, fiscal year 17, fiscal year 19, or 18, however we want to structure it.
Dennis, what you're thinking is maybe you're going to want it to be higher. If there's no provision
yes.
for that, you'll say, well, we better kind of get it pretty high so there's not going to get looked at.
And then the reason we are recommending more than mean or more than the average or more than the whatever is if it's not going to be looked at for 10 years.
Why can't we
suggest
both? If it is not going to be looked at, it'll be X number, and then we recommend a different number if it will be.
You know, you can do it that way. It could be plan one. If this is what it is, we recommend this. Plan two is, our recommendation is every 3 years, 369, or in the 10-year plan, that it would be adjusted 3 times.
Mm-hmm. Since we don't know what's going to happen with the economy, how about tying it to something like
Let me raise a point in politics, and I passed this one around that talks about shows GNP and then it shows median household income, which has been declining in the U.S. I think the politics of having an adjusted salary for elected officials isn't going to go very far. We can suggest that. I would maybe prefer to come up with a solid number, a fixed number, and then if we agree to recommend some sort of adjustment, and they can tie it to CPI or COLA or standard wages and different ways to do that. You can go that route. But I think if we start throwing out more numbers, I think the politics of that, the optics are going to be really bad.
Right. I think the CPI this year is like 1.9, 1.7 or something.
And that's different from what Social Security gets. A couple of years ago, they didn't get, I think, or 2 years in the past, they got nothing. And that's tied to wages. So that's, sometimes they get more than inflation, sometimes they get less.
It's sort of like question one on the ballot where they tied the gasoline wage to, because they didn't want to have to vote on it, so we'll tie it to
the one of the other things we talked about that we might include as a recommendation, I think it might have been your idea, Dennis, was to say, even though you only say at a maximum 10 years, we would like to recommend, and that we pick a number and say that we think this should be reviewed. It doesn't have to be by us, but whoever replaces us, this should be reviewed in so many years. Yeah,
Let me just interrupt. Who's taking minutes?
We've all had turns.
Oh, no.
Sorry.
I'm going to start over. You. We have to take order. I was first.
Right. I can't believe we're all in memory. Well, we applaud your dedication.
We could all do 20 minutes.
How did you do it last time? You just got the video and you watched the video?
That's all I did.
Yeah. No, I went up for last time. I just took notes and then I quick went home and did it because I can't read my writing after 3 days.
Okay, so there are a couple of options then. We could recommend an adjustment or lack thereof, plus future adjustments. We could recommend an adjustment lack thereof, plus tying it to some index of some sort. Is there a third?
Or hers, make a recommendation.
That they revisit.
They revisit how many years, right?
Within 5 years, or what, or in 5 years, or 3 years, or whatever.
I would, maybe less than 5 years.
Okay. Within 3 years.
And I don't feel strongly one way or another. The tiered thing I was talking about, I agree, if we say these numbers, who knows what happens to the economy?
Right.
Who knows who's going to be the city councilors then, I mean.
I would suggest, I'm going to make a suggestion that we go with the recommendation to review it in three, whatever number we come up with. In large part, because this is the first time this committee's met, and we don't know how our recommendation's going to be received, so I'd like to keep our recommendations kind of tight and narrow. And then the onus is on the council, and I think they've got an incentive to have people review their wages to call another committee to look at it.
I'm thinking that somehow be tied to the we were appointed at the beginning of a council mayoral term, so we want to kind of maybe do the same thing so that be on that
same kind of cycle.
We want to be our advantage of we started fairly early, you know, early in this year, but you know our work is going to get done now, but there's only enough time for them to act on it for the following. Time.
So they could do it every council. Every council could appoint a committee to review this.
It's just that by the charter they have to do it every 10 years. But if there's the mandatory, then yeah.
Or we could do it. I mean, every other council would be 4 years. That might be a compromise too. Yeah. But it should be early in the cycle of the beginning of
so that it can go into the budget cycle. Right. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, I'm fine with recommending. I mean, if the council wants to organize and they can find volunteers, that'd be great to do it every 2 years. Is there people?
Are the terms going up to 4 years?
No. The mayoral term is going up to
four. But not the council?
No.
I wonder if it's too much work to imagine that it could be done every 2 years.
Right.
I wonder. We've done a lot of work.
Maybe we should recommend that it go in cycle with the mayoral term.
Every 4 years.
Every 4.
That's actually not a bad idea. But then start it in year 3.
Right, so that by the beginning of the new term, you have the recommendation.
Consensus around that?
Yes.
Okay. So every 4 years,
recommendation. The cycle on the third year, so the recommendation is for the fourth year.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I think that's great.
Okay, so that then leaves us just.
And then that doesn't affect if it would be for the first year to make sure are they running again or are they not running again.
So you're right, that does make you think twice about if the person
makes a recommendation. And this is going to be broad covering all positions.
Yeah. Basically, that this committee will be reconvening every 4 years. Okay, that's good that we got that. That's a good one. So back to Mayor Train, did you have any other?
No. I guess when you first look at the numbers, it looks like he's. Like I said, it looks like we're at the low end. We are at the low end, but like I said, I was just trying to find some correlation, and I couldn't much except that there's a bigger variance between our budgets and those higher pay areas than there is a salary variance between our mayor and their mayors. So I thought it might be. So I guess what I'm saying is I'm not strongly feeling one way or the other. There's nothing so drastic. That I feel action has to be
wanted. One of the other things we talked about that I just wanted to put out here because it really had an impact on me at one of our meetings was talking about if the salary is not if the mayor is not allowed to do anything else. And if the salary is not adequate, we are closing out the opportunity for a lot of people that might be interested in running for mayor because they can't afford to for whatever reason. They have a family or there's no other income in their home or whatever. And so I would just like us to keep that in the back of our minds as we make a recommendation that it's not just about being comparable to other communities, but it's about getting a living wage and opening the opportunity for potentially more people.
What, do you have a number in mind, that, or a threshold over which?
I thought about it, but I just wanted to make that point.
No,
it wasn't even in terms of money. It was just like, you know, I mean, if I wasn't looking at this data, what I would say is different than what I might say looking at this, because I feel like you have to have a justification. The number that I was playing with was 90,000. That was before we talked about looking at it, you know, because I was thinking it's going to be a long time again. But again, when I looked at all of these comparisons, I was really struggling to find any relationships that would help me, you know, it just kind of jumps around.
And you also, we don't have, well, some of the data I had sent where we don't know who else is looking at this, and these numbers are going to change where they are in their cycle.
That's true. That's true. That's a good point.
That's what we wanted to find out, but we didn't have enough time.
Right. Which is like one of the things from that one of the cities, one of the cities that the stuff had done, they said they're going to raise, you know, there's one city, I somewhere in my stuff, they were raising, it was this now, but they were currently reviewing it, was going to go this year or next year to this new number.
But anyways, to add in two other brief points. One is that it has been 5 years. So, you know, if you think about cost of living, the percentage, that's not a lot. And the second is, again, looking at eye-watering this, the minimum of 85, if you look, is right smack in the middle of this chart. I know you don't all have it right in front of you, but it just seems like after 5 years, you couldn't not, at a minimum, raise it to 85,000.
What? I'm sorry now, excuse me, I'm cold sticking in. Just looking at the numbers, 85,000 from 80 would be a 6.25% raise, which is probably what over 5 years, cost of living, or a couple of years where they didn't get any. I'm guessing he'd be around there more or less, or what is that?
I would concur.
Okay, yeah, that's like 1.5%, which I think since the recession started, it's probably been.
Yeah, actually, I don't know what your experience is, but you know, we track compensation every year to look at our salaries, and you know, it was like 2-ish for a couple of years, and the last couple of years it's been 3 is what a lot of employers have been getting.
Okay.
I don't know. Municipal
people are different.
Yeah.
Most municipalities, when they're doing their package, depending again on how wealthy they are, structure it so it's like 3, 2, 1.5. 2, 2, and 2. 3, 1.5, 1. you know, it's all over the place depending on the money. But there's also there's other types of pay types. But they have longevity pay. I mean, things that are not in the private sector.
Right.
They have a grade and step system, so they get 2 rates. In between the steps is between 2 and 3%. There's a 2% on the chart. So what the people out there don't know is they're actually getting a 4 to 5% raise.
Yeah.
Like for our clerical and DPW, the charts are adjusted July 1st. The steps are in January 1st. Every 6 months, they get a raise of between 4 and 5%, because if it's a 2% chart and it's 2.5% between the steps, and there's 10 steps, you're getting a 4.5% raise every year, but it's 2, 2.5, and then the beauty of compound interest.
Yeah.
Right.
I just did the math there, a 2% raise over 5 years is a 16% raise.
Right.
So if you compound that,
right,
a little more than 10.
And so my figure I had was, the benchmark mean is 90,921, and I was going to say, given that we don't know when it's going to go up again over 4 years, I was going to recommend, I thought the number should be 92,500, is what the mayor said. That's just what I was thinking.
Okay.
But I'm not tied to anything, and I'm open to any kind of consensus.
Yeah.
But that was my thinking, is that if you do what you just did, that is still conservative, given the fact that it hasn't been adjusted for more than 5 years, and it's not going to be adjusted for at least four more years. Then you do, even if you did 2% over 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years, 2 times 9 is 18.
So it's effectively a 2%.
So by going to, I don't know what the percentage is of the current 80,000, what's 92,000, what is the
percentage?
15.625% raise over the current.
So then the justification for me would be, even if they got a 2% cost of living increase, and we're doing it retro, because the other thing that municipalities understand is retro payments, probably like at the university. So that contract, like all my contracts ended up June 30th, no, the civilian side, June 30th. I'm not going to settle, please.
But with any luck,
November. But we pay retro payments back to July 1st. So another way of looking at it is we are retroactively applying the cost of living increases that have not been applied to the position for the past 6 years, and are doing the same thing going forward until, if you choose to do our recommendation to reconvene every 4 years, a committee to again look at that.
Okay, let me just pose
a question. Makes sense.
You were working off of the 24 city benchmark.
The surrounding is 84.
Your median for
it's an average, but okay. 84,000.
84, okay.
And I know that from this one, when we were just doing these, because I was going to say, for example, we were just looking at this amount. I mean, I understand we don't necessarily have to look at 24, like Garda, but I was thinking like Melrose and Braintree are like, population-wise, are close to us, but of course they're on the eastern side, but they're at 125,000. So it's again how you, those two mayors are in 125,000, but of course it's a city environment, and Braintree actually has more money than Melrose,
their median household income is like 60% higher, so those
And so, I mean, that it's again what you choose that skews things, because then the median now is going to go up to over 100. And versus the opposite, you know, in terms of anomalies when they get to city clerk, because they have a different thing, but anyway, not that. But
we are required to live in Northampton?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You have to be a registered voter to be an elected official.
That's
a
cheap place to live.
Yeah,
yeah,
right.
Any other? So we've got Trey is kind of agnostic. Vicky, I hear you point about paying a salary to attract good candidates, to retain good candidates. And Dennis, your logic.
I'm just coming to remind you this of
But basically applying a 2% raise for the past 5 years and then prospectively for the next 4.
Linda,
it's 90. I think we're
grossly underpaying a mayor. When Dennis says it like that, I have to say I'm kind of leaning towards Dennis.
I think we have to justify it that way, because just on the surface you say, if you were to say, that's almost a 20% raise or whatever, then that kind of gets people's feathers up. So I think. But I think you did it well, that's the way we would justify it. Yeah. But I mean, it's real. It's not like you can't argue with that. You know what I mean? Like, but sometimes people can discuss, well, why did you choose this? Or I think you should have chose this. Or out of the 24, I would pick these 7. And why did you pick the, you know, talking about it within a municipal environment is the way I'm thinking in terms of explaining it to people, is just like the unions get their annual cost of living, the mayor's office actually doesn't do that. So you're making up for not doing it in the past, and you're accounting for not doing it into the future.
Yeah, right.
And then the other reasons are, like you said, is you can't have any other business. You cannot have a second job. I'm assuming by charter, like the charter in Greenfield is, the mayor cannot hold any other business.
Yeah.
You know, and it stops people from running, because I know people are going to run, but they have to give up their law practice. They have to give up their whatever. And if they're making 6 figures, and they're a business person, or Mayor Martin sold his business when he became the mayor, I don't know if that's why he sold it, but I mean, he couldn't run the business anymore.
And then, you know, I don't know what it's like in other towns. I only know what it's like here. And I know some, one of our visitors brought it up. But the mayor is at everything. You know, it's not like he works 9 to 5 and goes home at the end of the day. I mean, I see him all over all the time. I'm sure all of us see him all over all the time. I think it's that type of job that the expectation is.
In the middle of the night.
Right. When there's a crisis, you go to the parade and you go to the opening of this and the ribbon cutting and, you know what I mean?
You have a discussion between a town manager and a mayor with respect to professionalization. I mean, we could get someone in there with really very little education. Would that warrant a $95,000 salary? I don't know.
Well, if they're doing a great job, I think it doesn't matter. But, yeah, the question is, what if we brought someone in?
No, you can fire the town manager. You're going to pay him to buy out of his contract. So you will pay.
Right.
But, you know, the only thing for the mayor is, and it's true, and that's what and Mayor Narkowy said the same thing. Most town managers have masters in public administration. They have, you know, professional sort of skills. They have been doing budgeting that when they move around, they do. It's true. It takes your chances.
Yeah.
With your elected people that they know. And that's why the department heads, there's like no, when I said before, there's no school for mayor, there's no, you can get someone who's very bright, very engaged, very activated, active and very attention to detail and can do it. Or you can get somebody who can mess things up really, really fast, you know, and that, but that's the elected part is, you know, people want, they use the term, you know, a bum to put in the office and a bum to throw out of office.
Mm-hmm. Well, this,
and there's always the recall petition. You know, there's always, you know, that's the means of how you fire them. And then if they're doing that badly, then they, you know, file a recall petition process. But that way I go back to, and then I'll shut up, but it's about the governance, you know, and so you are electing the person to do this governing of the city. How well they do it or not doesn't mean that the office doesn't deserve that amount of money
mm-hmm.
versus their performance, because you're really talking about performance.
Mm-hmm.
And the way I'm approaching it is, what is the office worth, regardless of the performance, you know, so to speak. And then if that makes sense to you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sympathetic. I'm sort of with Trey, I'm a bit agnostic about what level of pay. I understand the logic for having some sort of adjustment and to compensate for inflation and cost of living. But I'm also, this chart that talks about median household incomes, you know, flatlining for 30 years, the idea that, because people aren't getting, most the average or the median household is not getting that adjustment. To extend that perk to elected officials, I understand the logic, but there,
my experience is different from that. I'm not sure where that data comes from, but again, you know, we get
Census Bureau.
Okay, we get.
Oh, what did I know?
Yes, I see the superintendent. I mean, the variations
right.
of it. And
well, we get reports
US.
Every year
yeah.
when we're updating our compensation
mm-hmm.
from a bunch of different organizations. That's what they do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they kind of pull together the data to offer. And we kind of do a review of all of them and look at, okay, what seems like the trend in business for the kind of increases you're going to offer in the next year. And usually you see a pattern, you know, it's between 2.5 and 3.5 or whatever. You know, usually it's a pretty clear
I think that's
pattern.
Fine.
So
yeah.
What I'm saying is for the last few years, the recommendations that we've seen from a bunch of different places has been 3%.
But that's why this is median household income, not
okay.
salary. We're
okay.
really about
but you're
households.
Saying it's not going up. So what I'm saying is that people are getting increases.
No, the middle. This says that the middle class, literally,
yeah.
the middle class has stagnated for 30 years. That doesn't mean that professionals, highly educated
mm-hmm.
people, are way up here. If you've got a BA, if you've been to college, you're doing great. But if you're the middle class, you know, in
well, middle class, many people middle class have a bachelor's degree, so I'm not sure you're middle class.
Technically not. I think it's about 50th percentile.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is the middle class income. This is, I
mm-hmm.
think, the typical voter. And if you look at the data, I'm not arguing against this.
Yeah,
I'm trying to temper. You know, if we're gonna sort of go with this logic that everyone deserves. A raise every year. That the average household is not getting that.
The average household in Northampton or the average household in the country?
Yeah, see, that's the other piece.
You know, we really have to think about our community and our surroundings.
I don't have the historical, but if you look at the data of Northampton, that we're not a wealthy, I think we've got a very median, I mean, we kind of fall right in the middle. So I am making a stress, I don't have any data to support it, but I think the data indicates we're more likely to fit this model than not, and that's why I just want to be cautious about that.
I understand, but, well, it's the difference between, you know, the global versus, you know, the forest versus the trees.
Yeah.
And like the Employers Association of Western Massachusetts, mm-hmm. which is, I know, one of the ones you use, who does surveys in Western Massachusetts through the Employers Association, which is based in
Babylon,
supports what you were saying. So even in Western Massachusetts, among, you know, and they're comparing jobs, you know, they're going administrative assistant, they're machinist, you know, they're going through
right,
all
we're
these
giving
classes.
The same cost of living to our whole workforce, you know, the people in the shipping department, the people in customer service, and the executives in our company. We're not saying the executives get 3% and everyone else gets 1%, you know.
But that's not, I don't know if that's typical for every, I don't know if that's
really not always.
Yeah,
it's
not
very
generous.
Yeah.
Why not compare the adjustments to you to the non-elected officials that work for the city?
No, I mean, I think I understand. I mean,
so did you have a number you were thinking of?
I mean, your logic is basically you're trying to keep it level, and that's basically what you're saying. For middle median income, it has been level. This is adjusted, this is real income, and so making that adjustment is keeping it level, otherwise, it basically is going down.
So,
I'm just talking out loud. I'm thinking out loud, and I'm comfortable with what you propose. This has been gnawing at me. It's been gnawing at me, and I don't want, I think what I'm most concerned about is there are some people, as soon as we publish our report, people are going to say, there are going to be 10 loud voices that are going to write letters to the editor saying that this is the fix was in, everyone gets a raise, it's party time, and you know, the average, and they're going to pull out this, they're going to talk about the fact that the middle class has been stagnating and we're giving. So I just want to have a solid defense of what we do.
Whatever we recommend, whether it's low or high, somebody's going to disagree, and all it is a recommendation. We're not getting to decide this, we're just getting a recommendation. You know?
I think my thinking was out of line because we're not offering them a real raise. We're trying to
keep them on par.
And I sort of feel, you know, when there are naysayers, I try to figure, just sort of stick to, well, what is our message? What was our charge? What is our message? And what is our rationale? And the problem is, I cannot fix the national middle class problem.
Why not?
But we can't do that. But here in Northampton, based on what our other communities are paying there and how this works, like in the stuff you were saying, that to attract candidates, to apart from the performance, what does the job do? And you know, when we have to say some of the things that like Mayor Nackwood said, I mean, he is on the Smith Folk, you know, trustee of the Smith Folk, he is on the Forbes Library. He is, along with Mayor Martin, are the two mayors for the Franklin and Hampshire Employment and Training Consortium. They're responsible for that entire budget, even though all of their health insurance and other monies run through Greenfield as the primary town, the lead town, city.
PBTA.
PBTA. I mean, there's, I sort of go with, you know, when they say, well, how could you? It's because he is a CEO, working mayor, responsible for it as the chief executive. It's not a figurehead, it's a working position. And then we name, you know, and write in the report all of these things that we've all been saying. And so, in our opinion, for someone who is charged with the governance of the city as a working executive, and also must sit on all these other boards, and is an ex officio member of every single committee and commission in the city, we do not think it's unreasonable that they should be paid with, you know, even above the midpoint of what the comparables are we've chosen, and for because of the lack of adjustment in any periodic kind of way. The way we were trying to structure it is to account for that, those long time periods. So part of it is to, that's why there's these big jumps.
Okay. Being times in the time, does anyone else have any comments? Or are we ready for a motion on this? Any other discussion? Someone make a motion. We'll vote on it.
I move that the mayor's salary be recommended to be $92,500 for fiscal year 15.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Actually, I have a question. We've already started fiscal year 15.
Yeah.
So
we're in the middle of it.
And I didn't think we
could. Oh, for next year.
Fiscal year 16.
Yeah.
Okay.
This has got to be.
Yeah.
Oh, it's for next year. Okay, sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, you want to make that?
I would like to amend the motion to say fiscal year 16.
All in favor?
Aye.
Full consensus.
I'm down.
Great.
But you have to actually say vote on the amended motion. The motion is amended.
Okay. Let's vote on the amended motion. Do we have a second?
Which is she
okay.
Saying?
All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Sorry, it's a Robert's Rule thing.
No, thank you.
Because we have a parliamentarian.
Dennis, I'm going to ask you, since you have kind of wrapped your head around this best, could you write up those notes for our department? I'm going to assign portions. Can you take charge of the mayor since you kind of articulate this in a way?
Right.
It would be great if we could all look at each other in case we notice anything.
My idea would be we're going to write this for the next meeting. We'll write this up.
Everybody will write
we'll
a draft.
Exchange.
Of the
we'll
piece.
Write a draft and then we'll stitch it together. Right. And then, like with your segment, I would suggest to include Vicki's comment about having a salary that's competitive and attractive. But that sort of thing. So I'll assign the mayor's section to you. Okay, next position is the clerk.
I was just thinking we should probably approach it similar to the same way that we just approached the mayor as far as a catch-up and a future, take into consideration the past and the future of when this is going to change again. I don't think the city clerk is as involved. That's the right correct. Actually, it might be before the correct, not as much extracurricular involvement than the mayor. Would that be correct?
Just
incorrect.
The elections.
Okay.
That's and in terms of overtime, if you're going to say being on call and then goes overtime, the only thing they would have to overtime the staff is the elections because the polls are open from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m.
But is that for every clerk?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. She made a point that because Northampton is the county seat, that she's a little busier than other clerks that don't have to deal with that county seat status.
Well, that's when I said, it's not so much the county seat, it's when I said before, it's where they were birth, death, marriage town. So it just so happens to be that if you have a hospital, you have nursing homes. You know, Goshen doesn't have a hospital, doesn't have a nursing home. But same thing with Greenfield is the county seat. So the clerk is responsible for issuing marriage licenses and recording marriage, birth, and death certificates.
More people are born and die in Northampton
because you're dying at the hospital, you're dying in the nursing home, you're not dying at home.
So it increases her workload.
Right.
But I don't think any more so than some of these other towns that we were
born. Right, not any more so.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that's,
Okay.
And I know these clerks from being a former clerk, so, and I ran elections, what I want to say. The anomaly for clerk, unlike for the mayor, is Agawam and Gloucester. Now, I happen to know the clerk in Agawam, and I happen to know how that salary became what it is. And in fact, that person is also the chair of the retirement board and makes over $100,000 a year. So the only thing I can say is that's an anomaly it's an outlier. If we were going to throw out the high and the low, if you look at it, the 64, the 54, 58, in green, although Debbie's going to be getting a raise soon, so that's going up, because she just became a certified municipal clerk. The other thing is, are they certified? Because it takes 3 years to get certified from the Mass Municipal City Town Clerks and City Town Clerks Association or the International Institute of Municipal Clerks.
What was the other organization besides that one?
Gloucester.
But it is Gloucester. But Gloucester is, it's because they have a part of it is they have a harbor. They also have, clam license. It's stuff that we don't have. There's a whole other licensing piece that the city clerk does in Gloucester. And I don't know about the politics of it. I just happen to know in Agawam. So that's why when I looked at the numbers here at the 75, I was going to recommend that it be 72,500 for that reason. That if you threw out the high and the low, the reality is, or throw out the highs for that reason. I don't know about Gloucester, but I do know the situation in Agawam.
Okay, well, just for comparison's sake, if you apply the same 15.625% raise that we're recommending for the mayor, you apply that to Northampton's clerk's current salary of 65,000, you get to 75,156. So it just goes to 75,000.
And for the reasons I explained, that's why I discounted
that. Okay, discounted off of that. Okay. Linda?
Well, I'd actually come up with around 75, but that was before I knew the information that we just shared, which was, I obviously didn't factor that in. And my recommendations are just a range. I'm not, tied to it. It was just a number in a range that seemed reasonable and fair with the data we have.
The average of our closer-in city group is 75.
And I can live with that. I was just sharing why I was discounting.
Sense. It was extremely interesting. One of the things I looked at was, and it applies more obviously to school committee and city council, was benefits. Mm-hmm. And what was really surprising me is there's actually a city clerk that does not get health insurance paid by the city.
So Linda, you were saying
I think 75,000 is reasonable. Westfield pays more than that. Holyoke pays more than that.
Well,
so
Holyoke is
they have much bigger quite
bigger. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was just gonna ask, you said if you throw out the you said you've done another you looked at the medians. By getting rid of Gloucester and Agawam, or just the local, the ones in our...
The ones in our close-in area, it's 74,000 and change.
And Dennis, while they're crunching those numbers, is there a discrepancy between them? Most of these are professional appointed clerks versus elected.
Right.
Is that, do you happen to know which of these? Are these all appointed professionals versus?
Yeah, well, what I had handed out for the appointed, the only elected ones are Attleboro, Beverly, Chicopee, Gardner, Holyoke, and Northampton,
and we're at the bottom.
So the rest of them are appointed.
Okay.
So there's, out of the 24 I did, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 are appointed. So that means 17 are appointed and 7 are elected. Is that 20, did that add up to 24? No, 18. 18 are appointed, 7 are. No, you're the man.
25.
Did I get right?
You're right.
I don't like math. I never sit for the CPA exam.
Good luck tomorrow, by
Thank
the way.
You. Mm-hmm.
So
So if we're just looking, we're taking out Agawam, because that's an outlier, but we're looking at Westfield, Holyoke, Chicopee, exclude Northampton, West Springfield, Greenfield, Pittsfield, East Hampton, we get an average of 64,504.
Right, that's what I was saying.
So
when you throw out the anomalies, yours, it's actually lower.
That's lower, okay.
But since she's already making 65, we can't recommend to lower herself.
Well, I don't think we could recommend to lower herself.
But that's why I say in reality, when you look at some of the other, look at some of the other ones again, whereas with mayor, I was arguing governance with the city clerk, that every city clerk does the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's birth, death, marriage, registrar, well, it be carved out. Voter, it's elections, dog licenses.
They have a wide variety of assistants for doing that.
Right.
Typically.
Right. And there is a staff there, so,
But I expect a wide variety of the amount of staff. I mean, we didn't look at that.
Yeah.
Right. Oh, you mean another.
Right. You know, Wendy talked about, she's out there at the desk.
Lack of staff.
Right. I don't know if in all offices you go and you get to talk to the city clerk directly when you show up.
In Greenfield, you do. We don't have enough people. It's true. I only have three people, one in the council full-time and three in the clerk's office full-time. So the clerk, if they're at lunch or someone's on vacation, the clerk has to work the town. And that's like with the mayor. It's the same thing. It's a working clerk in these under 50,000, 24 communities. That was one of why I chose it, is that they are, like, it's a working mayor, you are a working, I mean, not that the other clerks don't work, but I mean, you are working the county, you are,
not just supervising
and doing policy and stuff like that. You actually do have to issue a dog license and register somebody to vote and that kind of thing.
Jennifer?
Well, I was I concur. I think the 75 is right on, I think. And 64,504 is pitiful.
Mm-hmm.
Especially after 5 years, it's a long time.
Right.
I'm comfortable.
Your motion? Does anyone want to make?
I move we recommend that the city clerk's salary be raised to $75,000 per annum.
All in favor?
Aye.
For the same period of time.
Yes.
And all the other.
Yeah. Who would like to write this section up? Coming down the pipe is.
I think you want to sign it to somebody like you did to me.
I'll do it. Let's move on.
Be careful, whoever makes the motion, we have a pattern here.
Okay, so we got Dennis doing mayor. I'm going to take these a little out of order. Let's do the council. So now we're off to part-time elected officials.
Mm-hmm.
Let's do the city council first, because then I think council president will be referenced to that.
Just to make a note about council president,
sure.
Before we get to that, the East Hampton council president does not make $30,000 a year.
Okay.
Part-time, yeah.
That was actually $3,000.
Oh,
there was an extra zero typo in there. Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, everybody.
Now, is that on top of their... that's just their salary, which could
that's
be
what we got from Dennis.
Yeah,
okay.
They get $3,000 as the council president gets a stipend of $3,000, which is the same as the councilors. Some of them data I had is the president doesn't make any more.
Than the council.
Some presidents get a little extra. But in East Hampton, the councilors earn $3,000, and the council president also.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, I didn't catch that. But that was the question I had: is whether this is in addition to their stipend as a councilor, or whether it was just the total.
No, that is their stipend. Like, say for Gardner, their councilors get $6,500, but the council president gets $9,500.
Okay. Gotcha. Okay.
What I thought was particularly interesting on the city councilors is that about 75% of them get home insurance, and they consider
probably more than the city council is making. So it's not like you could say, well, they don't make very much, but they're getting this great benefit. They're getting, most of them are getting the benefit, and they have a higher stipend.
But we don't know that will always be the case.
I was just wondering, I was looking at that too, just now, yeah.
Excel must be broken.
Do you have your original? Because we have Methuen, it's $48,000.
No, no, the Methuen, the consulars get $4,800.
There it is, okay.
The council president gets $6,000.
Okay, that's gonna skew that.
Yeah.
That meaning of time.
I'd like to bring something up that we didn't, two of our speakers talked about, but we didn't talk about it as a group, and that is the at-large.
That they do more work.
That they do more work, that they get called in on anything. They, I think Phil Spector said, no, Paul, if they're, Paul Spector said, they're not, yeah, different, yeah, he's in jail.
But he was a great producer, I'm telling you, crazy.
Still, he became a murderer. Paul Spector said, you know, that they get copied. When I get emailed, the at-large guys get copied.
All right.
At-large people get dragged in. They're unhappy with their council person. They get dragged in. That they do more. They have, obviously, a much larger constituency. And I would like to suggest that we consider giving them some kind of token recognition higher.
That crossed my mind as well. I remember that.
In the surrounding communities, if you try to look at that, we're only, East Hampton is the only one below us, and everybody else is above us, but nobody being the same.
So the means and medians we're looking at are wrong, because they were based on...
Yeah, that 48. But actually, the median is going to be about the same. The median is going to be 8,000.
The other thing,
instead of 8,500.
Sorry. I was thinking another point that several people made when they came was that they didn't think the benefit insurance was fair, because some people were getting considerably more because they were partaking of a benefit that not everybody had, and they recommended eliminating that. And I thought that was particularly interesting hearing coming from the city councilors. It had already been on my mind, but I feel like it was reinforced and they're in it, you know. So one of the things that I was thinking is if we were to recommend taking that benefit away, some of that money could be used to then bump up their stipend and hopefully make it more in line with other communities.
On that note,
and more
because this issue applies to the school committee as well. So maybe we ought to peel off and address that, because I assume whatever we recommend for council, we're going to probably apply to the school committee. I could be wrong. And just to review that, and I don't know you have this year's compensation, the cost of the city for enrollment of four members in healthcare is $32,000. A couple of years ago when I looked at this, it was $38,000. A little bit less than what they're saying paying in stipend, but it's almost comparable. And I think it's even more with the school committee. The total cost of the city for the school committee stipends is $22,500. The city's paying $39,000 for insurance for four members. So
it's a little higher than
that. A little bit higher than with the council. But I think when I looked at this a couple of years ago, when you throw it together, they're paying about equal amount for salaries and health benefits. If you were to do away with the health benefits, you could double the stipend at no cost to the city. So I throw that out. That's an issue that motivated me to sort of get involved in this in the first place, is the equity best practices. I think there's also a bit of a conflict of interest that comes up when the school committee and council are voting on budgets and they're getting the same benefits that they're awarding to employees. So I would prefer to get rid of benefits for part-time elected officials for those reasons. But also, of course, to compensate them, to shift it so that people could still have the money if they need.
But that's not part of what we can recommend, right?
Sure is.
I think we could recommend it. I think your point is that ultimately it's in the mayor's authority, but I think we could make a recommendation.
To say that they shouldn't get health insurance and benefits because they can go to the exchange and then pay higher money.
I think when this was originally set up, access to group health insurance was a good perk because you could get competitive rates. That sort of disappeared now that there's exchanges.
Right. Except for the city's paying 80%.
Right, that's,
Another issue was equity. Some school committee members are earning 5 times in benefits as they are in their stipend. Others aren't. They're just getting their stipend.
It's also a very part-time job, and most companies, when you work under a certain amount of hours, you don't get benefits.
I'm thinking about your little graph again. The average person out there with a part-time job is not getting health insurance paid by their employer.
But don't they claim that they're working more than they, they're doing a lot more, and therefore they justify
it? Well, I think that's true for some, and I think the people that came and spoke to us are people that, have really taken this on and do more, but we don't know, does everybody do that much?
Mary LaBarge is probably the hardest working counselor out there in terms of
hours.
In her email, she recommended doing away with it. So, and I think Paul Spector put the hours at 10 to 14 or 12 to 14 something. Mm-hmm. He also recommended. Mm-hmm.
Usually the threshold for that is 20 hours a week. The most.
Well, under state law for municipalities, under Chapter 32B of Mass General Laws, is you must work 20 hours a week or more to be eligible for health insurance.
And
so, but special employees, which elected people are, that rule does not apply. I don't know of any, and that's each and every week. It's, you must work 20 hours a week or more. I don't think there's any city council that's working 20 hours a week on city council business 52 weeks a year.
And I think it's within our jurisdiction to make a recommendation that, hey, I like that idea. I like the idea that you said, Todd, was to maybe just double that rate that we've got now and eliminate the.
Does that account for past amounts, though? If we're going with the model that we should be paying for what they've done up till now.
I think a stipend is different.
Because I had one number for if they had health insurance and a different number if they didn't. Mm-hmm. And I was doing the same thing where, like, the richer communities that skews it, like West Springfield, they pay 8 and 10, but because of the strip and home, that whole thing, they get a lot of tax money then. But like we don't, and other places don't. Gloucester, same thing, being a summer vacation destination, hotel meal tax, stuff like that, where they get a lot of income from hotels and meal tax stuff. Versus when you look at, the North Adams or the, or even the Newburyports, city councils get $5,000 and $6,000. Because I was going to recommend that. The councilors get $6,500, the at-large get $7,000, the president gets $7,500 if they had health insurance. I don't know what to do with numbers.
You know what I did? I just divided the current cost to the city by the 9 councilors. Mm-hmm. And, it's roughly in the $3,000 to $3,500 range.
Oh, something.
That's what I did the other night, at least. We could double check it. And I was just thinking that's one thing we could do is sort of factor in, A, what are we looking at in other communities? We're way under. B, where we're moving a benefit, so we want to offer them more. C, we have that money. It's being used right now. Maybe we could redirect it into their stipends, which would bring them a little higher. But
right.
I hadn't factored in the giving a little more to the at-large, which I really like.
No, because I liked your idea for that. Because I do agree that that's why they're at large.
Right.
Yeah. And also, to get on the ballot, they have to collect signatures in each ward. They have to work a lot harder just to get to the job.
You need more signatures.
And,
and it's true that, you're going to write your counselor, you're going to
also send them to the at-large person if you have an issue.
And on that same, I know we're not talking about the council president, but I'm just going to slide this in on that same note. I had the same thought about the council president, because I feel like that's even tenfold that they get everything. And to me, a $500 differential seems pretty pathetic.
But Paul made the point, maybe this was in private or later, that the council president doesn't have to serve on committees,
right.
Doesn't have to chair. So there is more work, but he's also...
But they don't do committee work.
They don't do committee
work.
They set
the agenda.
They set the agenda.
They have to communicate with the clerk's office.
Yeah.
Stuff comes in to go to the agenda. Well, it's actually not the clerk's, they have their own council person, but...
Yeah, I would think, they're a bit at large, and I don't think it's much of an additional burden in terms of work.
Somebody that spoke, one of the city councilors, made it sound like they did a lot more. I don't remember.
Paul did, but when I spoke with him in private, he said the exact opposite. So, we're all out to change our minds. But he basically said, literally, I had a conversation with him to feel him out, and he said, council president is... because they don't have to serve on these committees, that's 3 or 4 hours a week
right.
That they don't have to, it sort of weighs out.
So he did say that they have to take the newbie in hand, how do I write
right.
a motion, and do a lot of work with new council members to help them know what's going on.
They have to run the meeting, they have to, set the agenda.
And they probably get a lot of the calls that the councilor and the at-large councilors get.
Well, because generally, I think the president has been an at-large. Typically, is an at-large member. So
has been.
Because you have more gravitas.
Well, I think the logic's been that they're more representative. They represent the city, and Claire was the president before she became mayor. Michael Barsley, Phil. Ray Markowitz and Neil, we all served as at-large.
Well, up until the charter change, I thought the mayor was the chair.
That's true.
Claire was, because she was the mayor, but...
She was chair, she wasn't president. There was a president, they didn't have a lot of power, then there was the chair, and the mayor chaired the meetings, but there was also a council president.
Yeah.
Sort of.
But that was one thing that changed in the charter, so that the mayor is not, but...
Mm-hmm.
So
chair of the school committee or the president of the chair of the council committee.
I was just wondering if we should vote separately on the benefit piece and then decide, because it seems like that makes a difference. If we all agree to eliminate the benefit, that might impact what we recommend for stipends, but if we don't agree, that's a different story.
Or do we do two things? We recommend the salaries be this if you get rid of the benefits. If you choose not to do that, we recommend the salaries be X.
I don't know that we should give them too many choices.
I was going to say, it might carry more weight or recommendation if we didn't give that
give
an
option, that as an
option. If we feel really strongly about it.
I would prefer we recommend the benefits be removed for part-time.
Okay.
Make a motion?
I move the committee recommend that benefits be removed from
part-time elected officials.
Second.
Third.
All in favor?
Wait,
aye.
Third, I don't have time for third.
Yes, you do.
All in favor of recommending the removal of benefits extended to part-time elected officials?
Aye.
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 Aye. Anyone opposed?
Abstentions.
No. I thought it was actually interesting, one of the Smith Volk guys was saying how he took the insurance, but he wasn't really he was paying it himself, but he was really only paying
the
copay. He wasn't really paying the whole thing, did he? But I don't know that he really got that.
Okay, so we dealt with the benefits for part time, so now we're back to counselors.
So that just potentially gives us a little more money.
Okay.
Do we agree with the three-tier thing, though, of regular council, at-large, and president, that change it from just two salaries to three?
Even though the likely, or historically, the president has also been at-large, so there would be we're talking about
two classes and an
additional stipend, or
I'm saying right now the counselor gets All counselors get a stipend.
Okay.
The president gets a stipend.
Okay.
And I'm responding to the
right.
The comments on the at-large should, the counselors should get one, regular counselors. The at-large counselors should get a different salary, presumably higher.
Okay.
And the council president would have a different stipend,
okay.
presumably higher than
even
the
higher
other
than
two.
At-large.
Okay.
That's what I mean.
Okay.
Right, 3 tiers.
Well, why don't, what if we were to just start with the bottom tier, build that foundation, and then we can sort of build up from there? Is that,
I think what Dennis was asking is, do we all agree we should have
yeah,
three
right.
tiers?
Yeah, but I know what the tier is. I mean, if the tier is a double salary.
No, but that was, we'd have to figure out what it was.
Okay,
to me, it's the concept.
Uh-huh.
Right now, it's relational.
Right.
We have a two-tiered system right now, counselor and president. My question is, based on the comments from the at-large in our conversation before, is do we want to go from three to a three-tier system, whatever the numbers are?
Okay.
It's the concept I'm saying.
Well,
should we?
In the event, if there's not consensus on that right now, we can proceed with the base,
right.
and then we can talk about, we can go through
sure.
the tiers. I'm happy to,
right.
discussing those. I think there's some merit in that, but just it's good at finding the right number that everyone's comfortable with. So you had said, Vicki, that if you took the...
I could do the math again, but what I came up with was about 3,500 if you divide it by 9. But that isn't taking the council president, right? Because is that 10 or is 9 included the council president?
If you look at the top of the second page, I've got the salaries. The total cost salaries is 45. Did you take the... The next line benefits, did you take
yes.
that 32,000?
Yeah, 651.
And again, that's
and
variable. That was up, but that was.
Right, I know, I was just
yeah.
using it as
okay.
a guide. I mean,
okay.
obviously it's
yeah.
not a given, but we could assume that in
yeah.
a given year it could be more or less than that. It's just
okay.
the beginning to start.
So what did
okay.
you say it was 3,500?
Yeah.
So if you added back to the 5,000,
right.
that would make it 8,500.
Right.
Is that where you're
you
going?
Just, she just got 30. Right, that was, again, just a ballpark.
Right.
Yeah. And I was thinking that, in addition to the fact that if you look at this, the 24 city list here, we are at the bottom, close to the bottom.
With no benefits, I could live with 8,500.
Mm-hmm.
I just divided that 32, divided by number one.
And again, like you
Cold
said,
medicine.
It could change. It was just a rough, number to play with. We could look at other amounts.
I like, looking at the surrounding communities, then we have Chickpea for counselors at 12,000, Agawam, Westfield, Holyoke, West Springfield, 10,000.
Well.
And then West Springfield, West Springfield
and Pittsfield
at 8,000.
So,
mm-hmm.
And they have benefits.
And they
right,
have benefits.
Right. Right.
Okay. Greenfield just voted to give themselves $3,000 a year stipends and free parking passes anywhere, including the street
in Greenfield,
including the parking meters. And nobody thinks that you get. I had to ask the finance director what I had to be at that meeting. And I was like, are they voting themselves free parking? Are they thinking about it? They're not thinking about it. They just did.
I just did the math that Vicki did. I got $3,627.
All right, and I have 36 written here.
Okay.
So I said around 35.
Okay.
Yeah.
So do we want to bump that up to, round it up to 9,000 and then help?
I would be comfortable doing that. I feel so strongly about the part-time benefit component
mm-hmm.
package that I'd rather give them an incentive. I'd rather reward them instead of just saying it's going to come out in the
mm-hmm.
in the wash. I mean, 9,000 or even 10,000, I'd be comfortable if that fits into the. Because on any given year, it could be that I think in the past it was it would have rounded up to 9,500 or so. So yeah,
I'm comfortable with 10,000.
I can go along with that, but it's the sticker shock thing. Like
yeah,
nobody
likes
that.
It's
sort of like
right.
like 90. I can do 9,500 because it just sounds like a lot cheaper than 10.
It's just like 1995. Oh, it's only 1995. And I get a nickel back. You know what I mean?
But I don't feel that strongly about it, but that was my only thing.
I think I like Vicky's rationale, though, of using that and dividing that by 9, the 32,000 by 9, and adding that to the current base salary. I think that's more, I like the soundness of that argument more than I do, let's just say 10. I mean,
well, that's how we're getting to
Yeah.
Right. So we started at 86.
So why are we bumping it even higher? Why is it going 1,000? Why is it going 15?
I don't know. I mean,
town paying for that portion of the health insurance.
Because we're taking away the
benefit. Right.
And then if you still look, the other surrounding communities are still getting more than that and getting health insurance on top of it. So it's justified.
And we're giving them kind of a token COLA.
Yeah.
So just to clarify, when you get rid of Methuen, the median drops to 8,000, correct? Because it had been 8,500, but if you knock that one off the top.
No, Methuen, they only get 4,800 and 6,000.
Well, that's what I mean. On my cheat sheet, I said the benchmark median was 8,500. That would drop to 8,000. And I assume has anyone updated the mean, the average?
But that's 8,000 plus health insurance. See, when I follow what Trey was saying, it's sort of like Pittsfield, it's 8,000 for the consul, 10,000 for the consul president. Same thing for, Westfield is 10 and 10. West Springfield is 8 and 10. Pittsfield is 8 and 10. Gardner is 6,500 and 9,500.
Yeah.
So that, if you sort of, if you throw out the lows like East Hampton at 3,000, Greenfield, throw out the highs like, Everett and Gloucester and Leominster has, 41,000 people. So, they're at 10,666. I don't know how they got that.
Well, to get back to Jennifer's point, what would be the rationale to go above 8,600, which is the current compensation, average compensation? I would say Northampton counselors are engaged in vigorous debate. Compared to some of these other communities, I don't think there's the rough and tumble.
I don't think we know that. I don't think we can say that.
Well, many of them don't have a foreign policy.
Yeah.
And why are we paying for that?
Can we edit that? Time consuming to have a foreign policy.
I think the most concrete thing that we can say is that most of these other cities get more and are getting 70% to 85% towards insurance. And if we're taking away the insurance, that it seems really reasonable
to double their salary. Yeah.
To bump it up.
Okay.
That plus the fact that it's lower than most.
Okay. I go back to I'm good with bumping up 8,600 to 9,000. I'm more comfortable bumping 8,600 to 9,000 than I am just going up to 10,000.
I agree with that.
I think it's easier to justify that extra $400 bump than it is to people are first going to say, oh, you're doubling it. And even though you can go back and justify it, I just feel more comfortable with 9,000 than 10,000.
Even though Westfield, Holyoke, Agawam.
I'm not saying it's not justifiable. I'm saying that's what I feel more comfortable with presenting. I know there's definitely that factor.
But even West Springfield, the counselor just gets 8.
Mm-hmm.
Pittsfield is 8.
utilization.
But again, the benefits as well, so
right.
I'm taking away the benefits.
So that's the other part of the
yeah.
But I guess
which is what you were saying.
There's a perception issue. There.
There's a perception, but the other thing is that we know, as we've already said, everybody isn't getting the benefits. So,
right.
So you know, maybe.
Now, yeah, and that's a. But this is also the recommendation is that all of these are to be reviewed every 4 years, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, let me throw in the other. I know we talked about this as a stipend and not as a salary, so maybe the COLAs don't really apply. But I think the 5,000 has been in place for 20 years or so.
I don't know that.
I think it's been a long time. It's been a long time.
Inflation.
But yeah, we don't have to do that. But I throw that out.
Well, again, it is a stipend, but even still, it seems like it should have been bumped up of such a long period of time.
But they have to vote on that, and they haven't been able to vote.
Right. It's one of those interesting things because people do put in a huge amount of time and energy and passion into these roles. But it is also one of the. How many of us are on outside committees that we don't get stipends for? This is little. But we all participate in things, and usually you do it because you care about your community or the organization or whatever. You don't really get anything other than that. So there is that piece of you're not doing it for the money, presumably.
Yeah.
Right, exactly. And it's great to acknowledge their work in some way, but hopefully it's not just about the money. People aren't doing it for that reason, in my opinion.
I agree with that. And then still 9,000 is not, I don't think it's still in line with everything else going on. If we go to 10, we're the second highest. If we're at 9, we're still kind of right there on the high ground in the middle, I think. I just don't think it's undercutting, even with the benefits, taking away the benefits, everything like that.
Mm-hmm.
But if we go to the 10, which I know it's only another $1,000 with 10% increase, we're three other towns with second highest. So I don't know.
Seems like we're gravitating around that 9,000 figure.
Well, that's what I thought, because I'm
saying. No, I've heard other people express comfort level. The 10 was. People aren't comfortable with 10. 8,600.
I can drop the 500 from my 95.
Like you're an
8999? Which is like card dealership.
Could you refinance for me? Or should we vote on this so we've set the base?
Okay.
Well, let's set the base.
Okay, let's get a motion.
I'll move that we 9,000.
I second that.
All in favor of recommending increase in counselor stipends or salaries to 9,000?
Aye.
Unanimous.
I'll volunteer for that one.
Okay.
Because I'm not going to be around for.
I hope we haven't used too much of your brain power. You got to cram your
slow ball. It's impossible to learn all this stuff, but it's going to come down to
hopefully you learned it already.
Well, I learned it about remembering it. Just the amount of knowledge. Part of it is luck with getting all the right questions, but not too many of those oddball questions.
That you didn't prepare for. Right?
Tax, they, there was a small appendix in my book on farm income. Taxation, and then I got an entire simulation on it one time.
Wow.
I'm like, oh, do I appreciate the cows?
They're getting older by the day.
I know. So.
Okay, well, can you hang around for a couple of minutes
yes.
to do the at large and we'll call the council? So now we're on to at large.
Would you ever, would anybody, instead of, if we kept it 2 tiers, are we saying the at-large would stay in the counselor tier, or the council, we would say that, and not like council?
By default,
that's
that
where they are
there.
Now.
Yeah,
right.
Okay.
We don't change it.
Yeah, so everyone now, by default, is getting
nine.
Do we want to offer an increase for at-large, and if so, how much?
I would suggest $500 more for each, to recognize that they do have a bigger constituency they have to serve.
$500 for the at-large.
So $9,500. And that's why I said before, $10,000 for the president. That would be what I would.
So the president would still get $10,000 even if they were, if they were from a ward.
It doesn't matter if you hold the office of president.
Right, right. That's right.
You don't get to double dip and
stuff. No, I'm just trying to make sure we're on the same page. So there could potentially be two at-larges at $9,500 and one president at $10,000.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're going to have one at $9,500 and one at $10,000.
Right, that's right.
Yeah. Right, there's three
at-larges.
What do you,
the city council president could be.
No, but how many at large are there?
Two.
But one of them could be the council president, is what it is.
Oh, that's
what
you're saying.
That was what I was trying to
figure out. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So one would have 9,500 and one would have 10, right?
Yeah.
That's what you're saying?
Yeah.
And that's effectively, it's very comparable. Currently, the president gets $500, and we're talking about doubling that to 1,000. And we're giving the at large members an extra 500.
Right. That was my thinking.
But my point was, if the president were a ward counselor, then that person would get the 10 and the other two people would still get
the 10. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Sorry. So there's very little
impact.
Anyway,
second.
Oh,
sorry, was that a motion? No, but it can be. It's like expediency.
So we have a motion to increase the compensated salary for the counselors at large to $9,500 and for the counselor president to $10,000.
Mm-hmm. So we have two motions.
Yeah.
We should probably vote on the first and then move to the second.
Okay.
Motion to raise, do we have a second for Linda's motion?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Raise second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Second, we have a motion.
Dennis, was that a motion that you made, Dennis? You said you recommended the $10,000 for the
No, we hadn't made it as a motion. That was in our discussion.
Okay.
So someone
can make it as a motion. That's fine.
Okay.
So we have a motion to raise the compensation or salary for the counselor president to $10,000.
Mm-hmm. I need a second. I
haven't
had a second. Can I second?
You second.
I second.
I think you should propose the next one. Stop writing.
All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous?
So why am I leaving you guys with?
School committee.
And Smith Vogue.
Thank you very much, sir.
Good luck tomorrow.
Thank you very much.
I would be too anxious to even show up. I'm sorry.
Listen to Mozart.
Yeah. I'll let you know in a month.
And Trey, thanks again for the work on the spreadsheet.
Oh, no problem. I'll fix those things and I'll be sure, obviously, to double check everything before
I'll email you with some. I think it might be, I know we had at one point, we had the median in there as well, and we stripped it out.
Yes.
So maybe
it's more
of that.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll
Are we going to meet? We are going to meet again before.
Maybe we should set that date.
But we have to have a meeting to vote on the report.
We need to set another meeting.
Okay.
What do you guys?
I'm having trouble with Thursdays for the next bunch of Thursdays. Does it have to be Thursday?
No. I don't have any recurring commitments. So let me know and I'll be there. Unless we can do it right now.
I know there was a lot of
beginning to get time pressures.
Yeah.
I saw on that slide. I'm like, oh, this has to be done in a month.
Couple weeks? What are we talking about?
No, I'd like to have this. I think the deadline I had in mind was by Thanksgiving. That's what I was told by the end of the month, so I figured by Thanksgiving. But I think we should, if we could write these things up and then meet and discuss and do the edit and do the final approval. I think we need just one more. Let me do the rest. One more.
Well, see, what you're saying is everybody would write up their piece and then
send it out in advance,
and then we come tie it together.
Come and then, tie it together and sort of approve the edits. I can do the sort of the intro. I guess we'll have an executive summary that we'll have to stitch together.
Thanksgiving is the end of November, is that what you meant? That's a long ways away.
No, I'm just saying to submit it to the council, the latter part of Thanksgiving, so.
Because what I was thinking is they might want us to come respond to questions and stuff, and I would rather give them more time in case.
I'd rather have them report this month and submit it, and then they can.
Okay.
What about, is Thursday the ninth? I do have one Thursday left. Is a week from now too short?
Definitely, yeah.
I can't, I have a.
Next week.
I have a wedding rehearsal.
Oh, yeah, I'm in Florida all next week.
Okay.
Florida.
Yeah, next week's not good for me, but from the 19th.
Yeah, no, wedding.
So what about the week of?
What about?
Wednesday is the 13th.
How about the ninth, 22nd?
I could do that.
Oh, shoot, I'm away.
Tuesday the 21st?
Tuesday is not good for me.
Actually, Wednesday's the 22nd.
Monday the 20th.
I've got something on the 22nd.
What about the 20th?
Friday the 24th.
I'm right, Friday, come on, don't do that to me.
What about the 15th? Is that not?
I'm gone.
Okay.
No, I'm not.
I'm here.
I'm here.
Oh, I'm here.
15th?
I could do that. I could do that.
Okay.
What time?
6:30, which we've done both.
I think this was the only one we did.
So back to 6:30.
This was tough for me personally.
Okay, 6:30 then.
Well, I'll book the room.
Book the room?
Yeah, I think they're gone.
I can get here for six and it's better for everybody else, it's just.
No, 6:30 is fine, it's, you know, if I get stuck.
What time is the library closed on Wednesday?
They're not open at all, but I have a key.
The key.
Okay, so we'll just knock on the door and talk a little bit, okay.
Or I'll just unlock it.
Wednesday, October 15th, 6:30. Great, excellent. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Have a good one.
Okay, so we're on to the, we'll skip the school committee chair for now.
Do like we did before, set the base.
Yeah.
That's funny, I don't have that separate on here, did I miss a page, or did you not make it separate? I only have school committee.
Yeah, I left out school committee chair because the mayor is the chair of school committee.
School committee and Smith Pope.
Right, no, I was saying school committee chair like it was a separate.
Oh.
On the spreadsheet, Trey had done that without realizing that the mayor was the chair of school committee. So we're on school committee, this one's a little interesting because it's a huge dispersion of.
Oh, my God, yeah. A lot of people, they get no stipend or benefits. 50%, only 50% get health insurance. 62% on my numbers get no compensation at all. I'm not saying we should do that, just for point of comparison, it makes it a little harder.
All of the school committee stipends range between $2,500 to a high of $6,000. East Hampton is the lowest at $900, everybody else is, you know, so I'd throw out the low.
We could even throw out that high, you know what I mean, because all the rest are really in the range.
Yeah, but you have Greenfield, zero, West Greenfield, zero.
Here again, do we want to think about the at-large members? I know Lou Duvall made the point that she has more constituents than at-large members, and that running for office is more onerous.
It does seem like we're doing it for one position that we should consider the equity of that.
I don't think it has to be a great disparity. I think maybe we should recognize the fact that they do have a larger constituency.
So if you, just thinking out loud here, if we took the same model that we did before, which was divide the insurance cost and add it back in, it would be almost a tripling of. So I don't think we want to do that. We can't do that.
What I was going to propose was to go to, what I was, you know, looking at it when it's like, you know, Agawam is 5,000, but the chair doesn't fit anymore. you know, Chicopee is like 6,500, Everett 5,500, 5,500, Gloucester 5,000, 5,000, you know, all of that. Newburyport, there's Fort Mile 2,500, 300. So I was thinking of 4,500 for school committee, 5,000 for at large, and 5,500 for.
There is no chair.
No, oh, there is no chair?
Yeah, the mayor's
the chair.
So we don't have to deal with the chair.
And then 5,500. Okay, so that's I only added it because I thought it was three chairs. Mm.
I was thinking 5,000 for the committee members and 5,500 for
at large.
Yeah, but, okay, that's.
One of the things that struck me is I forget his name.
Paul. Are you thinking of what you said, that there should be more of a disparity between?
No, this was one of the school committee members.
Oh.
Downey Meyer?
Yeah, I guess I just don't remember his name. And he was saying how one of their primary responsibilities is to select a superintendent. That's a pretty big responsibility.
Well, we've had a bit of a revolving door.
Well, that's true. But again, if we go by what you said before about the job versus how the job's being done.
Well, I was struck when he said that also their job is to negotiate, you know, with the unions.
Yeah, contract stuff.
And he happens to
be
a lawyer. But,
well, he does a lot more than because he has an interest.
Yeah.
The reality is these. It is the school committee who is responsible for negotiating with the unions, and they have negotiating committees. It's the same thing.
But it's more of an oversight role as opposed to a roll up your sleeves and.
No, they actually do.
Okay.
They really do it.
Okay.
So he's not wrong about that. But they have lawyer. They all go in with the school committee lawyers.
Okay.
It's so technically it's them, but the MATA brings in their. It's what's his name? Paul's the MATA, the regional set. He comes in, and then we have our lawyers go in. So it's not that they actually are responsible because it's too technical, but it's, at the end of the day, the school committee has to vote on it.
Okay.
Downey just seems to have has an interest and gets more involved in it, but. Yeah. Just
well, and also,
like
if you go by what
things.
Lou Duvall was saying, you know, she's concerned that there are a number of school committee members that don't do enough. Kept saying that, like, how do you engage them more? So I think you have the range, and when you give a stipend, you can only sort of give a stipend that's for, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can't say, well, the people that decide to do more get more than
people
do less, you know what I mean?
Punch
so you have to find some, right, exactly. Some people choose to do more, and some people choose to do less, and
I mean, I think what you're saying is five is fair, even though the data is lower than that, with the exception of the ones that I, you know, tag along.
I have to say this one time. I mean, I'm totally open to it, but I came in a lot lower than everybody else when I did my.
You know, I was somehow thinking what Paul was saying was that he thought that it should be even more. It should be 3-1 instead of 2-1. But if it was 2-1 in the current ratio, right now it's 2,500 for school committee and 5,000. If we're bumping the council up to 9, maybe 50% of that is 45. So I'm just thinking if that's, and I think someone else said 45 already.
I stick firmly at 5.
45 was when I thought it was three-tiered.
Where were you, Vicki? You said you came in.
Well, you know, part of it is I'm not just looking at the local places, but I'm just looking at the spread. And that would put us really high relative to everybody, everybody else. And what I guess doesn't feel totally fair to me about that is we haven't done that with the other positions we've just looked at. We've tried to be more, you know, moderate in the middle. So to me, it just feels, I'm not saying in any way that they're not or that I do not mean that at all.
The only
but
person
it's just looking at equity, I just felt like a really big leap to make.
That would be higher than us would be Chicopee at 6,600.
Yeah.
And they have 55,000.
And there are only,
people.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are only
and they also,
5.
That's a
range.
Lot bigger school system, too.
Right.
Yeah,
but again, we don't know when
those.
These are changing either.
That's true. But again, if you look at the budgets, city budgets, you know, it seems, yeah.
I mean, anyway. I hear what you're saying, but I'm so uncertain about how disparate the responsibilities might be at that level. Some of these committees might just rubber stamp things and go home.
So you're now saying maybe you can go a little less than that?
No.
No, no.
I'm not sure what you're saying, yeah.
I don't think we know enough about what the other town.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah. With too much emphasis on competence, we know our people should be doing quite a bit.
I think they used this earlier. I looked at the MCAS results. You're talking about quality.
They're moving to the other one now, the new system.
That'll come in a couple of years. But the I printed off the results for the middle school, which is struggling. A big issue that's come up, which surprised me, I went to the forum with the new superintendent last week. I've got a son in fifth grade at KFK. And a lot of people complained about the problem with the test scores, the mediocre performance. And the incoming superintendent said there's been a real issue with curriculum. There hasn't been a lot of coordination with curriculum. It's all over the place, different schools. He was kind of shocked at the lack of coordination. But I guess we've had so much turnover in that office, it probably doesn't come as a surprise.
Well, but there's also the position of actually curriculum coordinator. That's an actual educational position. So the question is if they hadn't funded that position.
No, they did. They had the position. The guy ended up leaving. I think he's...
That's the one you meant. Because sometimes they cut the curriculum coordinator.
They had one a couple of years ago, but things are somewhat in mess. And the reason I was bringing this up is I remember Blue Duval, we were talking about different subcommittees, the school committee, and she said the curriculum committee hadn't met in 2 years. I guess there is a subcommittee there that's supposed to oversight, should have been aware, but the school committee, Blue Duval was at this meeting with the superintendent, she was the only school committee member there. And I went up to her and I said, I'm just struck, because you'd said it at the interview that that committee hadn't met in 2 years. Why hadn't it met? I mean, obviously there's a problem.
Yeah.
We weren't aware of it. So I think to argue that our school committee members are more engaged or less engaged, there's some evidence that they've been asleep at the wheel, at least in terms of curriculum formation. It's reflected in the test scores and the superintendent's on record saying that that's their focus, their main focus. So bit of a anyway, I just wanted to raise that.
But that goes back to that's a performance issue, what you were just saying is, don't think of people. I mean, that's what I do in my personnel work in the city. Is I can't think of it because I have people departments coming all the time. I cannot think people. Yeah. Talk about the position as if there was nobody in it.
And that's fine. And I would just reinforce. I think I'm sympathetic to Doug's point about maintaining some ratio, and if we're paying the counselors $9,000, currently school committee members get half of that, at $4,500. So I guess I would lean toward that just because it maintains some.
The $4,500.
$4,500 is $5,000. So I think we're close.
I can live.
I put 47.5.
Why are you stuck on that?
I really think
number?
It's a mark of a quality community, and I really want to pay that position, you know, for what they do and the hard work that they do. And I don't know that if we can't hold the mayor accountable for the programmatic changes and fluctuations in our community, how can we hold the school committee accountable for just the MCAS results?
We do want to attract good people. I don't know whether the still very small stipend would make any difference, but
somehow I can't imagine the stipend is why most people do it. I think it's a thank you. This is great that you do it. We really appreciate it, but it's hard to imagine if that's why somebody's choosing to do it, you know? Especially not $2,500 for the hours they put out.
So Doug, where are you?
I
still like the 45, but I'm willing to go higher. Kicking and screaming. So.
You seem pretty agitated to me right now.
I need some more chocolate.
There you go.
Open the other bar. Get it going.
A couple pieces more.
One thing I will say, because we talked about this a lot more with the city councilors, is remembering that we've just taken away a benefit, and while not everyone is partaking of it, we do want to acknowledge that by putting the back in, so we should remember that as one of the reasons.
So are you ready for a motion?
Can you wait also?
I think you ought to make the motion.
We raised the stipend to $5,000 for school committee members annually.
Second.
And actually, well, to know is where we really should, if we're going by Dennis's Robert rules, this is where we actually have the discussion.
Yeah,
actually, I just wanted to. No, I'm not against that. The value of the health insurance really bumped these guys up, relatively speaking, quite a bit more. So that's why I'm willing to go to the 5. One of the reasons. Mm-hmm.
Okay, you interrupted, but okay, so we had the discussion, now we need to get to have the vote. All in favor of recommending a raise for school committee members to 5,000?
Aye.
Unanimous.
Would you like to make another motion, Madam Secretary?
Secretary,
And second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Yes. Okay. Smith Volk. Are you comfortable?
Yeah.
Okay. With the school committee, we doubled it. Mm-hmm. We took away the benefit. We doubled the salary.
Well, right now, Smith Volk gets the same as the school committee, so if we were going to be consistent for the same arguments, we would do the same thing for Smith Volk.
Sure.
But you know what's interesting, I'm listening to them when they came to speak, it feels like the trustee's role is different than the school committee's.
It's a little different.
Yeah, and I'm not saying that we wouldn't still do the same, but it felt like they have more oversight of the school than the school committee. The school committee members have a very narrow focus,
right. And
it seemed like the trustees have a larger...
They do, but there's a lot of politics there. If you recall, the mayor tried to fold that into to sort of rationalize that system.
Which
to
I agree with. But
I do too.
I think that they do see if they got to go in there and get two signatures on a check or something like that. Mm-hmm. It seems like it's a bit of an antiquated way to run a system, and they're fighting tooth and nail to keep it that way.
Right.
So I'm not.
Isn't it endowed though? I mean,
it is.
Endowed.
Yeah.
So shouldn't the endowment be paying a little bit more for
their
stipend?
It's a small endowment.
That's how they get away with being an independent group because they've got this quote endowment, but realistically they couldn't operate without the city.
Right.
You know, they need that, but then they get to be their own little school district. But again, they only have one school. I mean, whether they...
They've got a superintendent, they got trustees, a superintendent,
a principal.
Which
is why I agree with the mayor.
Yeah.
I mean, we're paying for a lot of administration that is duplicated.
Yeah.
The same thing with the financing, the treasurer, the the efficiency would be to roll it in, but I think that's why you'd be with me.
It's beyond the scope of our
unfortunately. But it could be one of the reasons for not having it the same, to argue against what I said before, if they were both getting 2,500, to raise it, but not necessarily in the same, because there's one school, there's not six, there's, mm-hmm. you know, for all those reasons.
Mm-hmm.
I agree. I think whether the system should be reformed is not in our remit. I'm comfortable with following the model of the school committee and doubling that, since we're taking away the benefit.
And you know, there's only three Smith Oak trustees. There are nine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so in
school
some ways it balances it.
Right.
Yeah.
But could they have more? I mean, are they limited to only three? Is it, that's part of their charter? Just
I'm
three?
Assuming it is, and I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, there's three people on the ballot. I mean, there's
yeah.
three positions to vote for.
Well, if you were to take the $4,400 that's now being spent divided by three, that's what
1,500
1,500. That brings me to 4,000, and I'd be comfortable with that as well.
Yeah, I would too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, but we should be really clear in our justification. Is that because it's got less scope than the school committee?
It's less students. It's less school. It's one school, less student. Not multiple schools. Not. And they do not negotiate the teachers' contracts, I don't mm-hmm. think.
Right, I think he said the superintendent.
The superintendent.
Superintendent, exactly, exactly.
That's true.
So in that sense, the responsibilities are less.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you don't want to say it that way because okay. I mean, obviously the responsibilities are what they are. So it's not less, but you know, I guess different, or not as broad in scope.
Right.
They're also not dealing, I think, with the same constituent issues, the broad population,
right.
the school
community. Well, yeah, a lot of the constituency is outside of town, and who don't even get a vote on
yeah.
who they are.
Yeah. Yeah, so they're, and also, I think their meetings, you ever film the Smith Oak meeting?
They say they have a different schedule for their meetings.
Oh, and they're not, they don't have any cameras.
Yeah, they don't allow cameras in, so they don't sort of embrace.
They don't have to because they're not public. Are they quasi public?
Oh, okay. So they're not also subject to the same scrutiny and transparency.
Well, apparently, if they can outlaw cameras because. The loophole is the small endowment, which gives immunity.
I thought it was a large endowment.
What happened?
What did you say? He said it was a small
endowment.
The
small endowment, which gives immunity towards public.
No, but you said they could outlaw. Oh, I'll
look.
Okay.
Yeah, because I would say, you know, if they have the right to do that, then it's because they have the ability to do that.
Oliver Smith.
They
actually
have
money.
$4,000. I guess the neutral would be the, if we're going to keep compensation where it currently is, it'd be about 4,000.
Right. Doing what we did for the benefits and adding that
yeah,
in and what the bump was for.
Yeah.
So if you were going to do a bump, then it would be 4,500. If you
okay.
weren't going to do the bump,
okay.
it would be the 4,000.
We have to remember we have our previous logic about at large, so the president and gentlemen are all at large.
Yeah.
Right.
yeah. But they're all,
mm-hmm.
but it's the same job.
Mm-hmm.
Do they have to get signatures though from every ward?
I don't know about it. I don't know.
I think they.
I don't know.
I would think they must, but maybe not.
Do we have a lifeline?
No, we worked on that, and I think we just kind of blew through the whatever requirements. I don't think they do. I think we were very specific about the number of votes, the number of signatures. At large members had to get from each ward.
Well, the Oliver Smith will make control of that.
Yeah, that's true.
It may not have anything to do with the city charter.
Well,
But how do they get on the ballot, though, I guess, is the...
You have to take out nomination papers.
Yeah.
But they can just go take papers, but you may not have to go canvas.
Yeah, I don't...
It's the same as the Charles, the Forbes, yeah.
Okay, so you take out papers, but you don't have to canvas signatures, though.
Well, no, for Forbes you do.
Yeah, no, you have to get X amount of... You still have to get X amount of, I'm just saying, I don't know how many signatures they need to get, but it would have to be registered voters of Northampton. It doesn't...
Yeah.
The sending towns, you're right, they have, they don't have any say to that extent. So where are we, somewhere between 4 and 4,500, is that where we're at?
I think so. What a good thing.
I have to say that I have a hard time saying that I favor one type of educational community over another in our town, and I would like there to be greater parity, I think, between the two. I don't want to penalize or the perception of penalizing the vocational school system.
Yeah, I agree with that.
I don't think we're valuing it more. I think we're saying that they're different, but I hear your point about the perception.
Yeah.
Well, certainly if we make a different recommendation, we get a lot of discussion.
The cows will be down to this.
So, meaning you're leaning more towards like 5,000?
Yeah, I am, so. But I don't, I mean, I know it's probably hard for people to hear, but.
I really have a hard time with that. I just really kind of felt like they kind of did the work they did because they liked to do it.
But that's true of everybody.
I mean, that's all of these positions.
But
I think that's true.
The actual position, what they really do is really all that much.
They have to go sign checks. They have to run back and forth and sign checks.
Just so I never really felt like I got a sense of what they did.
No,
I kept asking that question. We know what you choose to do.
They've got the superintendent who does all the administrative work.
Yeah, I don't really get a sense. It's hard.
I think it's going to be hard to have a different...
No, I hear you.
Amount for that school system.
Well, I don't understand, maybe this isn't the venue for the politics, but the mayor tried to reform last year, or 9 months ago, and that was squashed. Do you have any sense of what stopped those reforms? Or why the mayor backed
down? It's the same thing with the we have Franklin County Tech and Greenfield, what's actually in Turner's is actually where it is, but... I think it's largely emotional in to the extent that there's a great fondness for, there's a whole thing on MCAS and education. It's a place where students can go to learn trades, to learn farming, to do, and they are a unique, they have a unique mission, separate from school systems. And so it has a long history of I think people having affection. And then for that as an entity, so it's not necessarily rational. And then the second thing is the claim for independence, meaning that if the city took it over, even though you would streamline these administrative things, now it means we're under your control and you can change the mission of this, which isn't really true because the mission is still the mission, but the perception is that sort of Big Brother takes it over. It's like a corporate buyout, like you're going to buy it out, you're going to move, and then you can drastically change the character, the mission.
And change the funding stream as well, because the funding stream would presumably be reduced or rated, okay.
But the counterpoint to that was that it's the only one in the state that's got that type of relation. Every other vocational system is
rural. It's contributory by the towns, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. And it's because it has this... unknown and
but so I understand the logic for and against, but the mayor backed down. Do you have a sense of what I don't recall what happened in the press?
Well,
you just didn't want to
pick that your battles.
Okay.
You know, if you it's what politicians do, you count the votes.
Yeah.
Okay. If you don't.
Well, he picked the battle, and then he. Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, you.
The alignment with the pay.
And it didn't become it. He advocated for a position. You know, and then when you get pushback, you know, but politics, it's like whatever you do in the city county, you're counting your votes, and you have to have one more than 50%.
Yeah.
You know, or if there's seven councilors, you need four.
Yeah.
If you only got three, well, you wait for another day.
So that position was really. The other councilors seemed to be behind that thing.
I think that there was a lot of, when I say affection, that's what I mean about a pushback or resistance is the community lets their councilors know or lets the mayor know, you know, that they are siding with, we need to be independent. We need to not, you know, how we can keep true to our mission is to not be taken over by the city. You know, I said, the city wants to take us over. Versus you're in this partnership together.
I think there was a lot of fear. They have very high expenses in terms of buying equipment.
Right.
That an ordinary
college prep system
has books, but they don't have the stuff that they need to buy.
High tech lathes and stuff, and that
stream would evaporate.
And I'm not saying that that's not legitimate, those concerns, but, you know.
I'm not either.
But that was the, that to answer your question of the, what is the political banner?
One other thing, besides it feeling weird to give them something different, is also the fact that they have been the same for a really long time. And I feel like if we were going to change them from being the same, we would have to have really, really clear, solid reasons. And I feel like we have some, but are we clear enough to be able to say why we're changing it? Because we are right now.
Okay.
Yeah,
I agree.
And for your perception thing, it's like, well, what are we perceiving?
Right, and I think that's really going to be a hard sell.
So. I would like to.
Would you like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion, even though I was the one that didn't want to go. That we raise it to $5,000.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor of raising.
Discussion?
Discussion.
Did you say something, Doug?
So what did I miss when I left the room?
We just made a motion. Did you?
No. There was some discussion.
We just basically said that it's been the same for years. It would be hard to all of a sudden make that those two different school committee members in essence have different.
To give them parity.
And they have to buy heavy machinery and expensive kind of equipment.
Yeah, that's. It's not a deal breaker for me, though.
So
now we're going to.
All in favor of. All in favor of increasing the salary of the Smith Vocational School trustees to $5,000.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Yes.
And there's no chair or anything like that, right?
No.
They're all the same.
I'm sorry, who seconded? I didn't catch the second. Is it you, Todd?
No, I didn't second.
Dennis seconded?
I didn't say anything.
I think
this could be your chance to do it.
Hey, who's going to write up Smith Voc?
Who's writing up school committee? I'll write up school committee if no one has. I have notes.
Okay.
I'll do Smith Voc if I have to do it at one.
After
doing laborious minutes,
five pages of minutes. You shouldn't have to really.
Yeah.
There's only two people left.
You do, okay.
I'll
just
do it.
Do you want half time? That's what happens when you wait till the end.
Can we pick a date that we will have them done and send out to each other in advance of the meeting so we can all come with notes?
So what are we looking for? What's the format we're looking at? Kind of like a few paragraphs, like a...
Well, on the worksheet, I put some background information. So let me talk this out. I was thinking that we would there'd be like the introduction would state the current situation, and then to With Smith Voc, we can sort of keep it short because we're recommending again. I think with each of these part time, we have to roll in the withdrawal of benefits, and then to say we recommend an increase in the salary to compensate for.
So just we're looking really just for a narrative.
Yeah, a narrative justification. But if you can start each of your sections with kind of stating the current, so there's a context to what we're doing. And you've got those, although some of those median and means have changed, but we'll...
But you don't have to put those numbers in there.
Yeah.
So what you're going to say...
Put the current salary.
Right, the current is, and if we could find out, maybe from Wendy, the city clerk, or from Smith Oak, actually when they were... I'm going to call Glenda to find out. Because she had convened that committee when you did the mayor's salary. I'll find out when was that.
Okay.
You know, exactly. That was.
Okay.
And if we can find out, perhaps, you know, from the city police, the school committee and Smith folks' salaries have been this for 12 years, you know, then you can say, so that's why we're, you know, looking at it. They've been the same. Smith folk and the school have always been the same stipend.
Okay.
Throughout.
So you'll follow up and
well, I'm going to just call my part and the mayor.
Okay. Could you share that with
us? I would put that in my draft.
Okay.
You see what I mean?
Okay.
And I'm just thinking perhaps whoever's writing those sections, you could, if you wanted to, you could find out if anybody even knows how long has it been $2,500. You know what I mean? When you were talking about your current. The current has been, for the past 15 years.
How would you be able to find that out,
I wonder if the payroll people might...
I'll email Glenda.
Okay.
Can find out, and if she doesn't know, the city auditor might be able to...
I'll ask her, and I'll do it for everybody, and for every position that we're writing our report, we're missing this data. And I'll share that as soon as I get it. We have less than 2 weeks before our next meeting. Would next Friday be... time enough for people next Saturday? Friday the 10th or the 11th? How much time will people need to...
Probably do it by the 11th.
I would say Saturday, Saturday evening. And then we at least have, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday.
So the grace period could be Sunday noon?
I'm calling the dogs,
I have two weddings and a concert on
Saturday. I'll do my best.
Okay.
I'll do my best. Okay. I'll make it happen. Yeah. I mean, we're not talking about...
We're talking about a paragraph.
Yeah.
But I'll do the background. And then what we can do, if you send them through, I'm happy to sort of edit this into sort of a coherent, stylistic sort of thing.
There's also a paragraph about the health insurance removal from...
Oh, okay. I'm happy to do that.
The other question I have, and maybe it isn't really totally germane, but there was a point, these stipends were set at a point before the health insurance was an issue. So there, at some point, they kept the same stipend, but then they got the health insurance. That might be interesting to know. Because they actually got a big bump at that point.
So it's not everybody.
Right, yeah. So maybe it doesn't really matter. But I'm just
Well, actually, under the law, they always had access to health insurance. So from whatever time they got a stipend, because the...
It's the discretion of the mayor, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, but... No, that was just a recent... That's true, but historically, as soon as you have a stipend, you are now a special municipal employee, and you are entitled to health insurance. And I suspect there was never a time when they had a stipend and didn't get health insurance and then added it.
Okay.
What I'm saying is I think those were simultaneously, only now that because the law was such so that the Board of Selectmen or the mayor can, by executive order, change that.
Okay. Okay. Well, I'll contact city and try to get that, at least fix those dates for the last.
Right. And it may be, who knows, they may say, look, from the time we've had a school committee, they've always had a
recent memory.
You know what I mean?
You know what I'm thinking, and we can decide this when we sit back down together, but
we're all going to write a different style. We may have the same information, but we're all going to write a different style. I think it would be nice when we put it together to have all of them have sort of the same format. You know,
well, that's why I think it was useful to talk about just starting with the current salary, you know, what we're proposing and our justification and things like that in that format.
But even still, well, we'll see.
No, there'll be some editing job to style. But you want to make sure that the points, the important points, remain in there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm happy to sort of tie it all together. But so long as all the bits stay, hopefully everyone will be okay.
Or we could all try to write like somebody else. And then it'll, maybe it'll come out more even.
I am Dennis.
I'm going to try to write as Vicky.
Oh, wait,
okay.
I forgot to write down that we were adjourning.
Okay. Motion to adjourn. Well, so we're going to by next weekend, so we have about 10 days. Try to get it. If you get it sooner, sooner the better. But
And distribute it to everyone?
Distribute it to everybody. Yeah, we're sharing. So we've got to look at it. We'll come next Wednesday to review, do a group edit, make sure we're
I'm just wondering, do we want an in-between stage? Maybe I'm making too much work of this, but if we see, like, really obvious things missing, couldn't we just kind of send a little note to the person that did it so they can insert it?
We already talked about
Right.
I think it might save time when we all get together.
No, I think anybody can comment on that. Or I wouldn't even care if what I sent is somebody puts track changes on and it's all in red.
Well, that's my point. We can pull it a little more together before the meeting so that we're really finalizing it when we sit down together.
I'm still on Windows XP. I can't make anything work.
Well, here's what I'll do. You guys send me your stuff, and I'll put it on a Google Doc so that those of us who can, we can edit changes.
We should send them all to everyone, and then you'll get it too, and you can put it up there.
I'll put it up there.
Right. Well, right. Motion to adjourn.
So
Somebody has to finish that talk.
Someone will.
Who's second?
Linda did. All in favor?
Aye.